Good afternoon and welcome to today's Sunset Safari. My name's Brent Leo Smith. I have Tebs on camera, Jamie and Andrew Joseph Francis on the other vehicle, and we have Kirsten and Nicola in final control. So welcome to a sweltering low-fault day. It's about 31 degrees Celsius, 88 Fahrenheit. So unfortunately, we didn't manage to find any cats on the Sunrise Safari, but the leopard tracks didn't leave. So I'm doing another scout around the area to see if we can find the leopard tracks. And a little bit later, we have another new presenter trying out, and he's going to jump up on the back of our vehicle and come on with us a little bit later on the drive. His name is Neil, Neil Bone, and we've known each other for quite some time. I've actually known him since my first year at boarding school. Neil was a few years above me, so known him for a very long time. He's been in the bush a very long time as well, so very exciting having all these new presenters trying out. I'm sure you guys will be nice to him, just as you were to Brett this morning. So just in case that leopard, having a drink in the road, is the first sighting of the Sunset Safari. And look at that, for the birders out there, it's a nice little Aquila eagle. Now, I know we've been focusing quite a bit on our bird lists, and I've started a live drive bird list, and I haven't got this one on the live drives yet. And I'm also not gonna make it too easy for you guys. Let's see if you can figure out which eagle this is. And remember, you are able to send us an email, so email me the answers on questions at wildearth.tv. Or if you're a little bit more technologically savvy, just whack the hashtag in front of Safari Live and pop it on Twitter. Oh, off it goes. So there we go. And you can see, as it took off there, feathers all the way down its legs. And that's what let us know it's one of the true eagles or Aquila eagles. Very, very pretty bird. Surprised we didn't hear any squirrels break out in panic as it took off.
Afternoon station, mobile, any out there?
Nothing yet, we've just got mobile. We did have Nkonzo of Wanunengwe on Bertella this morning, no sign of it crossing out, so we're following up in the area. It was seen on that Juma Dam cam last night, so I think Jamie's checking the Mawati and that area, see if she gets any luck with some tracks.
Hi,
Bobby.
Thanks,
Bray.
I'm
going to go for the copy, thanks. So, if there are any new viewers out there, you see I'm on the radio. And you've got to remember that finding animals is a team game. The more of us out there looking, the better chance we all have of showing you guys the most fantastic stuff. So, we are always in contact. And that helps us keep a sort of ear to the ground on the movement of animals. So, welcome Sarah on the Sunset Safari. Sarah's a bit worried, said, why are we trying out new guides? Are any of the guides leaving? Don't worry, Sarah, none of us are leaving. We are getting some additional guides, that's all. And, where did it go? Seems like I'm having luck with this particular bird species. We had a fantastic view of one this morning as well. Oopsie, sorry, Tibsy, that was my fault there. Oh, there we go, we got two different species there. So the top one, even though it's difficult to see in the shade, is that violet-backed starling or plum-colored starling. And you can see how it's opening its mouth like that. And if you look carefully underneath the beak, it almost looks like it's fluttering. And what that is called is a gula flutter. And that is to try to help cool them down. It's one of the cooling mechanisms birds use. And then below is a red-billed buffalo weaver. He's also in the deep shade, also probably hiding from the sun and doing a bit of preening. So red-billed buffalo weaver is a new one for my live drive list. And then we had the violet-backed starling this morning. Fortunately, sitting in the shade, so we can't see that wonderful iridescence. Now, it's been very interesting. We've noticed that while we've been so dry, a lot of the sort of migratory birds like woodlands kingfishers, carmine beaters, pygmy kingfishers, violet-backed starlings, what else? Paradise flycatchers haven't been that much abound, but I've noticed definitely this morning, and European rollers, European beaters, as soon as we've had that rain, there's definitely been an increase in woodlands kingfishers and some of the other migratory birds, so we will be keeping an eye out for them as well. So we had that mystery bird this morning, which proved to be quite a challenging little lark. And I'm pretty confident now that we can mark it down as a melodious lark, as one of the only lark mimics that's about. So here we go, nice one. An LBJ for the serious twitches out there. Some of our viewers have bird lists of over 200 from the live drives. Isn't that incredible? Now, this is a very strange thing that's happened this sunset safari. I've gone past the Gallagher waterhole, and I'm coming around towards the Juma Dam camp, and I have not seen one buffalo bull. And they have been sort of camping out in these areas, and although it seems quite strange, it's not really. That little bit of rain would have filled in a lot of the pans, so you'll find those buffalo are going to be wallowing up in a bit of mud that is not the exact same one that they stay in, so there might be a little bit more grass around some of the other pans that have now got a bit of water in. And as you can see, that water did not touch the dry, desert-like basin, which is now the Vuyatela Dam. Well done to Marilyn in Montana and Donna in North Carolina, who were spot on with that bird. It was a pale morph Warburg's eagle. Well done, guys. And while we continue to check around this area for the possibility of leopard tracks, let's go see if Jamie has had any, or has had better luck than we have so far.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome on board Jigger for this part of the Sunset Safari. For those of you who are new to our show, a big warm welcome. My name is Jamie. I have Andrew on camera with me this afternoon. And while Brent goes to check around the Juma Dam, I've come along to check the drainage lines surrounding it. So I haven't seen any tracks crossing north into that famous block between Mbubu and Gari cutline. It's a very thick, very dense block. So I'm wondering whether or not that leopard decided to go down into the drainage, into the Wati drainage line. Apparently there's something very rattly making a noise in our car. Andrew, do you hear it? That's very strange. I can't hear anything unusually rattly on Jigger. Is there something flapping? I don't think so. That's very peculiar. Well, we apologize for whatever strange noise is coming through to the microphone, and this is the microphone itself. Maybe knocking. Doesn't look like it. Might have come loose a little bit. There we go, try and adjust it a bit. Okay, so we might have found the problem, which should explain why we couldn't hear it, because the microphone is just ever so slightly knocking onto the dashboard. It's all right. We will sort nothing that cable ties and duct tapes won't be able to remedy at some point. I hear that Brent's been doing bird quizzes this afternoon. I think in return, I might look for some tricky tracks to try and catch you out. It's difficult to catch you all out. I'm not sure if I've ever managed it. Well, our new viewers, for your, or to help you understand what I mean, we very often challenge viewers to different quizzes and games. And almost almost every time. In fact, I can't think of one example where I haven't got at least one correct answer. Our regular viewers are on the ball. In terms of my possible track quiz, Michael Fleetwood, you were wondering how long it takes you to memorize the individual animals' tracks. Are you talking about different species, or are you talking about individuals themselves? Because we have chatted before about figuring out which animals they are from the tracks itself. With individual species, or with different species, it comes fairly quickly for the easy ones, like elephant or rhino or hippo. Those ones you can see pretty quickly. And I would say it only really takes you a week or two of looking at them. Sometimes difficult to spot them, of course, and that just comes with practice. I guess you get, it's not really so much recognizing them. The idea is to be able to recognize them fast, so that you don't have to stop for too long and double check and triple check what you're looking at. So with hyenas, for example, you don't want to stop for every single hyena track you see on the road. So you get used to the way that they walk and the shape of their tracks very quickly, so that you can dismiss them quickly. If you're looking, for example, for, as we are this afternoon, if you're looking for leopard tracks or even lion tracks, depending on whether or not one of them decided to come over onto Juba. In terms of individual animals, which is something that I touched on, it is possible to identify them. And I've actually chatted a lot to Steph about this. He knows some expert trackers that actually walk around with, essentially with calipers, to measure the tracks. And they say that they can, with almost, I don't know, about 8 out of 10 times, get the identity of the animal. But for that sort of thing, you're talking about leopards or lions, something that's area specific, so something that has a territory, and you can just narrow down who it's likely to be. Now for us, the only female tracks that come onto Juma that we're likely to get confused with would either be Karula or Shadow. Shadow's feet, from what I've observed, are much tinier than Karula's. That's just come from a couple of months of observation. But I wouldn't say that I'm confident to any kind of degree of accuracy. Not confident enough to say that's definitely Karula's track, or that's definitely not Karula's track. Rhino tracks I've been able to identify individuals from. That's because I spent months and months and months tracking those particular individuals. When you look at the track itself, you can usually identify little features, a chip in a toe maybe, a slight, so many helmet strikes riding through. They're such fast little birds. They don't seem to want to settle down. I'd love to be able to show you them, beautiful birds. They're not playing, being a bit uncooperative. What my favorite bird is in Africa. Right now it's not these helmet shrikes, because they're being thoroughly uncooperative. They're hiding in this knobthorn somewhere. I can hear them. Let me just switch off so you can hear them as well. Oh, and now they've gone quiet too. Cheeky birds. And what I'm going to do while we look there is I'm going to find you a picture of my favorite bird to show you for Joseph and for all the others. It is a difficult one though, and it does depend a little bit on my mood. But I would say probably one of my absolute favorites is the Verroes, or the Black Eagle. Unfortunately, not one that we're likely to see here. You managed to find them there? No.
Yeah, I did.
Oh, did you get them? Oh yes, there we go. Well done, Andrew. Andrew's the hero of the day for managing to find one very tiny black and white bird in one very dense tree. It's gone. Cheeky things. So helmet shrike's not on the top of my favorites list right now, but this is one of my favorite birds. It's the most magnificent eagle. It's just a little bit smaller, than a Marshall Eagle, which we do see here occasionally, with a beautiful white V along its back. You see them in the mountains. They are, to me, one of the most awe-inspiring birds of prey. Just so beautiful. And I think there's something so striking about seeing a purely black, or almost completely black, eagle. One of my other top birds is a secretary bird. I love secretary birds. I think they're extraordinary, and you never know. We could well see one on these live safaris, particularly around that Arethusa airstrip area. They are unique and well-adapted snake hunters, raptors with long, long legs like a stork. My other favorite bird species be. What's your favorite, Andrew? Do you have one?
I like ostriches.
Okay, Andrew likes ostriches. That's fair enough. Also, a bird species that we could see out here. The largest bird in the entire world. I didn't even think about an ostrich. That's a good answer. I don't like ostriches because they bring back memories of being terrified of them as a kid. I don't dislike them. But I think I was slightly traumatized by being chased by one. So was my little brother, actually, as well. I watched one take a piece of bread out of his hand. He was holding it like this. He was tiny, tiny. He was still a toddler. And I don't think he ever quite recovered from that. That and the warthog attack, where he was thrown unceremoniously into the air and onto his bottom by a warthog. No harm done at all. It was actually a baby warthog as well. And that spelled the end of any potential of Angus having a career in the bush. He is now, for those of you interested, living in Scotland. And no immediate plans to come rushing to work out here. What other birds? Oh, we were talking about ostriches. Largest flying or largest bird in the world. Obviously flightless as well. Chatting about all the various birds of prey, we wanted to know if there are gymnogenes in the area and if that is the same thing as a harrier hawk. And yes, it is exactly the same thing as a harrier hawk, and we do get them. There's in fact one that has been nesting on Vulture's Nest Road. Sometimes our birds like to confuse us with road names and where they decide to put themselves. He nests there. It's very skittish, that particular gymnogene. So I personally haven't managed to get it sitting on the nest. So we'll go nice and slowly through here. Make sure that this male leopard didn't come a-wandering. Here, kitty, kitty. Oh, probably shouldn't call him that. It might take offense. And Rich, my plan is to go across to Vulture's Nest in a little bit if I don't pick up any tracks here. So I'll have a look for you, and maybe we could see a gymnogene today. A gymnogene, or an African harrier hawk, is a bird that's specialized in raiding other birds' nests. So not a popular bird out here. Very often, if one is even considered to be a slight threat or is just sitting in a tree, the fork-tailed drongos of the world, as well as the hornbills and the rollers, tend to attack and mob them. Still no tracks coming through here. Let's just go pop our noses into the drainage line under the jackalberry. See if maybe there's signs of tracks there, or even the leopard itself, of course. Compared to the last few days, it is very hot, and I think most things are hiding away in the shade. So while I go and check here, let's get an update from Brent's side.
We've done a big circle around the Juma Dam. No luck, no tracks. I've got a sneaky suspicion that leopard might have ducked into the little river system that runs through the center of Juma, the Mawati. And Jamie, Stephanie, you're gonna have a look there. She's in Jigger, which gets better signal, so is able to go into those deep, deep drainage lines. So we're gonna have a quick check around quarantine. And then I'm going to head up towards the western sectors to try to find some elephants. Darlene. Welcome, Darlene, who's from New Hampshire. Darlene would like to know, will we ever get to see an impala lily, and why is it named that? Well, Darlene, they do occur naturally in the Sabi Sands, but generally on rocky ground. We don't have many rocks here at Juma, as you can see, but sandy soils. So it's unlikely we're going to see one on the drives. Jamie and I actually have a big one in a pot on our deck, and that we bought from Hoedspruit. So there is one there, and when it flowers, maybe I'll lift that heavy pot out so you guys can have a look at it. And Darlene, impala lily, I'm not 100% sure why they're named impala lily. Guessing maybe impala like to eat them. There's also a kudu lily, which has got long spikes on it. But also, we're not going to see those here. But I'm not 100% sure why it's called an impala lily. Maybe you guys out there can find why it's called an impala lily. And if you find that information, let me know. Send it through to questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. So we had the tracks of that one male lion that marched through the property in the early hours of this morning. And they were found in Torchwood. And it seems like all five of them are there to the east of us. And just talking. And this morning we found a very, very challenging bird out there, a little LBJ. And Janice in Baltimore says, did we manage to identify it? So Janice, what I'm quite comfortable saying now is that it was a melodious lark, one of the only larks that mimics, because it wasn't the normal call. And those white facial masks, streaky breast. We couldn't quite see whether it had white windows on the tail or the color of its feet because of the glare from the sun behind. But I'm quite confident it was a melodious lark. Not a monotonous one, believe it or not. There actually is a monotonous lark, a monotonous lark as well as a melodious one. Welcome to a cold place. Steph, who's in Switzerland. Beautiful, but definitely on the chilly side. Although in summer months, Switzerland is very beautiful, especially around Lake Como. Steph is wondering, do we get broad-billed rollers in the Sabi Sands? We do. I've never seen them on Juma, though. I've seen them on the Sand River quite often, actually. So about 7 or 8 kilometers to the south of us, I have seen them. And not to say, with the right amount of rain, we might see them up here, but I don't think this year. It's the very, very pretty roller species, and it's probably the only roller that occurs in the Sabi Sands that we haven't seen on the live drives. Well, definitely not since I've been here. Maybe some of our long-time viewers might remember if we have seen a broad-billed roller before my time on the live drives, but I can't remember of any of the presenters seeing one since I've been here. So just in case you were wandering around the internet and you managed to bumble upon us, we're on a live African safari on Juma Private Game Reserve at the moment. And we also are interactive. So you're able to ask us questions and about anything you might like in the African bush. And we'll do our best to answer them. Do that by emailing us at questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. So we saw a wonderful little Warburg's eagle on a little bit earlier on the sunset safari, and Miss Jen in the Lone Star State, Texas, is wondering, are warbirds bigger than bald eagles? No, they're not. Bald eagle is actually a very big bird. I'd probably say almost twice the size or even three times the size of a warbird's eagle. Bald eagles, even bigger than the African fish eagle, although they look quite similar. Their size is massively different. And quite often a lot of people wonder whether an African fish eagle and a bald eagle are related. They're not. There's a very interesting little evolutionary theory about sort of parallel evolution. So bald eagles are also great fish eaters and not like the fish eagle, but they probably have a shared ancestor with like Stella's sea eagle. But in terms of their coloration and adaptation, they've sort of evolved to look very similar to the African fish eagle, even though there's no relation and they're very, very far apart in terms of distribution. A parallel evolution evolving into the exact same sort of features and habits without ever actually being related at all. Well, that's not entirely true. Everything's related, since we all spurned from a single-celled organism by the name of Spirogyra, a blue-green algae. And if you consider survival as the sort of benchmark for a successful species, there's only been one successful species in the history of the Earth, and that is Spirogyra, blue-green algae, been around for 4.2 billion years. Isn't that incredible? So we're going to head off and go pick up Neil from Final Control. While we do that, let's go to Gemma and see what she's been up to.
There we go. For Rich and any others that were interested, this is the nest that I was talking about, the African harrier hawk, or a gymnogene, as it used to be known, and still is in my head. I still haven't quite adapted to using the new names, yes, just yet. No sign of life, no chick poking its head out, but we do know that this harrier hawk is still around. I've been looking around trying to check if it's in the area. Maybe, as I said, it's quite skittish, so it might have flown away as we came in, but I didn't see it. Might also be out hunting. But there's a very good chance that we could see one on these live drives. This is what a gymnogene looks like, or a harrier hawk. Fascinating double-jointed legs, capable of bending at 90-degree angles backwards, so that it can clasp onto a branch and reach around and dig in animals' nest holes. Beautiful bird. That yellow around the face usually flushes bright red when it gets either stressed or excited. Something fascinating to see. Well, we'll see if we get any juvenile harrier hawks popping out. They should have fledged by now, I would have thought, but I haven't seen any. I noticed with our pale morph Morbergs that nest there, and this harrier hawk. They don't seem to have been all that successful during this breeding season, unless we've missed it, but I don't think so. We check those nests very regularly. We're now sort of reaching, what are we in? We're at the end of January. I wonder whether this drought has maybe played a role in the way that they, or the successful rearing of their chicks. I've come along Vulture's Nest, not specifically to look for that nest, but actually to look for tracks of this male leopard that was wandering around. It's always a good idea to check the drainage lines of an area. I wondered where he came from and who it was. Just chatting about things we might see. The socially awkward girl wants to see another spotted animal of ours, but in this particular case, you'd like to see a giraffe. Always possible. You never know. We see them fairly regularly, almost, at the moment, almost every day. So I'll keep an eye out for you. I promise you, if I find a giraffe, we will show it to you. Apparently the male and the female and the young calf that we've been watching over the last few weeks, male's still with her, still waiting for an opportunity, or waiting his time to manage. He still hasn't, from what I can tell, still hasn't managed to seduce her. He has been trying very hard. But I promise we'll keep an eye out for you, socially awkward girl. I'm sure we can find you a giraffe. Might even find those three. Hopping down into this drainage line. We've spoken, our regular viewers know we've said it repeatedly. The fact that these drainage lines are so productive for finding things like leopards is partly because it provides them with this ideal habitat where they can slink through the bushes. Also provides them with plenty of shade, nice big trees. No, that's kudu tracks, that is not leopard tracks. But it also provides them with an abundance of prey species, because the drainage lines usually, although all very quiet this afternoon, but they usually have lots of animals wandering through them. They tend to hold moisture and carry nutrients more. That's why you get those big trees that grow around the drainage line vicinity. And it means that the food provided for the animals is ideal. So the tracks haven't come out here. I think there's one last possibility to check. I'm just going to make sure that he didn't come around down here. Whoa. That was unexpected. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is why you should always be very careful walking around these areas at this time of year. So the dams are empty, and after a little bit of rain, the little pans fill up. That was such a surprise. Shame. I think it was a surprise for that hippo as well. Let's try and go around the other way, just to go around the other side so I don't spook him further. Get another view of it. That did not look like, for those of you, because I know, I'm sure you're going to ask whether or not that was Peter. It looked like quite a young hippo. I don't think it was him. It didn't look big enough to be him. No sign of a bear. That was such a surprise. These live drives, they keep you guessing. The bush keeps you guessing. So as I said, the dams are dry, the space is restricted, but with that little bit of rain that we had, it's filled up all of these mud wallows and pans. So when the animals go wandering, particularly hippo at night, they get to the stage where they think, actually, I might just settle down here for the day. Now, if we can't get a view of it from this angle, I'm actually going to leave the area and let it move back in. I don't want it to feel obliged to go wandering around in the blazing hot sun. Now, of course, hippo are highly nocturnal, and their skin is very, very sensitive to the sun. And that's why a lot of them are seriously struggling and suffering at the moment in this drought. And again, this is where it comes down to the fact that pumped dams have, you know, unintentionally caused this particular problem, because it's brought hippos into an area where they wouldn't usually be. And it means that in drought times, where the hippos can cluster in the big rivers and the big pools where they belong, the ones that have now moved into this section of the Sabi Sands are actually struggling. And that's why there's that, it is hiding in here, shape, sort of a very deep resting place. Let me try and get over, here you go, and have a look in there. That's where the hippo was hiding. Now, just have a look at how steep, you can see where, how much the, it displaced the mud and the water. Look how steep those sides are. That's where that hippo climbed out. And how fast it moved. That's what I should have asked you. It would have been a really good track quiz. What made those sliding marks along the mud? If I hadn't seen it with my own eyes, I don't think I would have known. Well, I probably would have. I would have been able to see the hippo tracks if I checked. What I am going to do is I'm going to call it in on the Game Drive channel. And the reason I'm going to do that is in case anybody goes tracking and wanders about on foot, particularly in the Mwati drainage line. Because a hippo like this in a stressed out situation, doesn't feel very comfortable, immediately ran from the vehicle, is actually fairly dangerous. So I do just want to let the other guides know. Stations, there's one in Vubu around Spaghetti Junction in one of the pans. It's just run down towards the Mwati drainage line, just to let you know. Here we go. so that nobody gets a surprise. That's affirmative. So Craig just sent me, I will explain to you while I'm chuckling. He's still talking to me. We're chuckling about it. So basically Craig is having a good chuckle because he understands what it's like to be surprised by a hippo and the warning that I was giving. So he's essentially saying to me, did you get a bit of a fright? In a slightly, he didn't quite phrase it that way, but he did phrase it in a very amusing way, one which I'm going to keep to myself, but suffice to say it is rather funny. Let's go down here, see if this hippo's popped out here. There's nothing like a surprise hippo particularly, and I think Craig thought that I was on foot when I'd seen it. We all know those moments. You were just saying that you love the fact that you can go out daily with us. You really enjoy it. And you were wondering if there's specific hotels or accommodation that you could stay in. You're saying it looks like an ideal honeymoon destination. And David, yes, we live at Vuyatela on Juma. We live next to Vuyatela Lodge. There's also Galago Lodge. One is self-catering, one is not. And they will take you on regular game drives out and about. Of course, there's also Arethusa Lodge if you want to mix things up, maybe spend a few days at one and then the other. Now, the awesome thing about it is if you do come to stay either at Vuyatela or at Galago, you'll actually be able to explore areas that we don't necessarily get to go and visit. So the Juma guests get an extra level of experience. They can go into Biffleswick and Torchwood, all around there. And you'll get to see the characters that we've spoken so often about. So to see Karula in the flesh, or Tingana, or Mvula in the Inkuhuma pride. You'll notice I'm going very slowly and very carefully, just to make sure I don't surprise that hippo again, as I did the first time, as much as it surprised me. I doubt it would have crossed this drainage line, but I'm checking for tracks as well. Probably on its way back to the pan already. Shame. Now, generally, hippos, when they're in the water like that... I must finish chatting to David first. David, if you have the opportunity, I would strongly advise it. And, of course, if you do come up to Vuyatela or to stay at Galago, you will be able to come and meet us, come and see a little bit behind the scenes, even watch the setup of a drive if you would like to. We have done that for other fans of our live safaris. Your eyes peeled for that hippo, everyone. It's going to be hiding in the bush or in the shade if it is here. And while I search for our hippo and other wonderful things like the leopard, let's get an update from Brent's side.
So there we go, another one for the bird list, guys. A very pretty bird sitting on top of a Combretum calling, a golden-breasted bunting. Here we go, you can hear him calling. Almost, a little bit more high-pitched. Looking for ladies by the looks of things. So out in a prominent perch, making lots of noise. Come on, call again, please. Or not. He's very, very vocal. That's how we found him. Bit camera shy now. There you go. Another lovely one for the bird list, for those who are just starting the bird lists, for the avid birders, I'm sure you've got this one before, but it's definitely another one for my live bird list that I'm keeping now. So I'm in competition with all you guys out there on the live drive bird list. Decided it'd be quite fun. See if I can catch up to, I think, who's leading? 225. Who's got the biggest bird list out there? Let me know what your bird list's sitting at, guys. Do that by popping us an email on questions@wildearth.tv or hashtag Safari Live. How big is your Safari Live live drive bird list?
Stations are located the other...
So we're hoping there's some eddies up in this area at the moment, so we're going to sort of maneuver around. So we had probably, I guess, about 25 or 30 millimeters of rain two nights ago, and it has greened up the landscape incredibly in that short time. But if we don't get much more rain, it will dry out very quickly, and the grass will start getting that sort of sunburnt tinge again. But yes, Pat, much greener, well noticed. Hopefully you might even find some wild flowers. On the edge of that little puddle, that's one of the wonderful things about having a bit of rain around. It makes your butterflies a bit easier to spot down to the right a bit. There we go. So let's have a look. I think, yes, you see it's almost a very lime green color. That is an African vagrant, and it's drinking from the moisture surrounding the pan there, and you can actually see a whole host of other bugs flying about. You can't really see what they are, but you see that wonderful sort of very soft lime green, and that's one of the telltale signs of an African vagrant. We can't really see it. It's also got a very distinct black spot on the outside of the wings, but we're a bit far away. I'll see if we can get a bit closer. Just a bit closer. There's two African vagrants much closer. We might be able to catch the spot there on them. And they're actually feeding on a pretty little yellow flower. There we go. Oh, it's just, you see there? Oh, can't see the spot just there. But you can see there's a tiny little yellow flower. It's hoping for a wild flower or two. There we go. You see that little black spot down towards the base of the wing when it... And you can see it on the inside when it flaps, oh, off it goes. But that tiny little yellow flower there is called a yellow justicia. And so when, during the colonial times, when a lot of these areas were broken up and the areas were named. So in the southern Sabi Sands, near the boundary of Singita, there's a village there where a lot of the Singita staff live. And it is called justicia. So named after the flower. The Sabi Sands has about five or six different justicia species, and that one being the justicia flava, or yellow justicia. My favorite is the felt justicia. It is white with purple polka dots. But I haven't seen one yet, so the wildflowers have been a bit few and far between this year due to the lack of rain, but I will be keeping my eyes open for any. In search of increasing the bird lists, Bill Burkett is saying, do we have any hummingbirds here? We don't. They are endemic to North and South America. We have sunbirds, which are similarly shaped, but not quite as dainty as a hummingbird. And they do spend more time perched than on the wing. So they often will be feeding on the wing. The most common one we have here is the white-bellied sunbird. As we're wandering past, we'll see the butterflies flutter through, and all of the ones I'm seeing seem to all be feeding on that yellow justicia that's obviously just come into bloom. Happy butterflies. Up ahead there, so there's just a little open area, and there's just a bunch of those African vagrants all feeding, and almost you just see them flipping around little justicia to justicia, and they're all on those yellow justicias. Yeah, isn't that wonderful? I do love butterflies. One of the more challenging creatures to get on camera out here, and that's what makes them so much fun. Quick link to Jamie, who's got quite a rare bird.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I think we've just found the grey-hooded kingfisher that we've been on a mad rush to try and catch. I'm trying to see the light. It's so difficult to be able to confirm that, but that definitely looks to me like a grey-hooded kingfisher. Grey-headed kingfisher. Now, that's really exciting for those of you building your bird list. It's quite an unusual bird species to see in this area, and I know that many people have been trying to get hold of it to put it on camera, and they've really struggled. It is the grey-headed kingfisher. Awesome. From what I can see, oh no, hold on, looking in this light, no, brown-hooded. Damn, I was so excited. It is brown-hooded. It doesn't have a chestnut belly, and I'll show you. Tricky in this light. Pity. This is the grey-headed that we were after and that we were getting all excited about. But you can see it's got this brown belly underneath it that we can't see. I can see directly into the sun, but it definitely doesn't have that. So what we're looking at is this little bird, the brown-hooded kingfisher. Also, just as exciting, I suppose, for those of you building up new bird lists. And I know that we've been talking about the bird lists and all the things that we are looking for. So sorry, my mistake. Looking directly into the light, it is a brown-hooded and not a grey-headed. But we will get one. We will get a grey-headed kingfisher on camera. So we encourage all of you to... Kirsty's just said to me from FC, an A for effort. We tried. Got all excited. Next time, Kirsty also says I get a gold star. Thank you, Kirsty. Next time we'll get the grey-headed one. Look at the squirrel. The squirrel just shot through, picked up something from the dung and ran across the road. Where did you go, little squirrel? What did you eat? Shy. Playing hard to get. It's going to come back out again. Quite very common, and we've spoken about this before, for the squirrels to be raiding elephant dung at the moment, which is what this one was doing. It's after the half-eaten marulas that they leave behind, partially or almost, in some cases, almost completely undigested. Oh, at this time of year, we might see it in the next few weeks. Might even start to see baby marulas growing out of elephant dung. Of course, for them it's absolutely perfect. They've got, once they do germinate, or once the seeds germinate, if they manage to escape the squirrels, the raiding squirrels, if they do germinate, place to be. Here's another squirrel doing exactly the same thing. Hello, you. Did you not find a marula fruit? Did you not get lucky? Dashing off. Yes, young marulas germinating in elephant dung. It provides a really nice, basically a fertilized pile in which to start their lives. It's not often that we get to see baby marulas. We usually only see the large ones. The littler ones get absolutely hammered by the elephants. Okay. This leopard definitely hasn't crossed along here. So the next step, I think, is to go and check along Vuba Road, see if we can find it there. And Darlene, who's watching in New Hampshire, and regularly sends us through wonderful questions. Darlene wanted to know, is it because of the leopard and lion concentrations that we don't see cheetah? Because she would absolutely love to see one on a live drive. And Darlene, we have seen cheetah before. We have managed to put them on camera before. It's all about getting lucky. And yes, to an extent, you are absolutely right. Just move out of Jackson's way while I chat about this. Oh, it's Aubrey. So yes, Darlene, we do get cheetah, but you are correct. The high concentrations of leopards and lions in this particular area. Afternoon. How's it? Cheers. Enjoy. So it is partly the high concentration of leopards and lions, but most importantly, first of all, cheetahs require huge, vast areas of space. And secondly, this is not really their favorite habitat, although they don't necessarily target the grass plains as much as you might think they do. They like slightly more open woodland where they can really get their speed up. There's an individual cheetah that wanders up and down cheetah cut line regularly. The last few weeks we've just been missing out on seeing it. It seems to be because it's summer, it's also moving about earlier in the morning, so it's still in the dark just before we go live. The other thing with cheetah, of course, is, as I said, they cover huge areas. They like, particularly the females, like to move in vast, vast spaces. The males tend to at least have a little bit more predictability, a little bit slightly more predictable than the females, because they move through to patrol territorial boundaries and to mark along territorial routes. Cheetah are fascinating creatures. It's one of those situations where, and we know that they are endangered, they are quite rare, but it's actually one of those situations where scientists and biologists are actually saying this is a natural progression of a species that actually didn't work. So it hasn't survived, not necessarily just because of mankind's influence in this particular case, although we've had plenty of influence on the decline of other species, but in fact because they need such huge areas. They're highly, highly, highly specialized in terms of the way that they hunt. What is the squirrel alarm calling? I didn't. I was too busy chattering about cheetahs. Well done, Andrew. And after that dwarf mongoose sighting, I will never ignore any alarm call ever again. I'm trying to be able to see it so that we can get an idea of where he's looking. I'm going to switch off so you can hear what a squirrel alarm call sounds like. Not the only one calling either. Keep your eyes peeled, scan the trees with Andrew. See if you can, there we go, there's the reason. Sitting on the dead tree. Uh-huh. There we go. And that's what was attracting their attention. Oof, in this light, hard to see, it's not an eagle. Could be a snake eagle, without the feathers all the way down to the feet. Try and have a look through my binoculars. Ah, I think it's that juvenile goshawk again. What? Yes, it's definitely one of, it looks like one of the juveniles. It's got mottled colouring. And we have seen it here before. I can't see its face. I can't see if it's got that red starting to develop around the bill. But that is what the squirrel is shouting at. Sounds like, whenever you listen to squirrel's alarm call, it kind of sounds like a mad witch's cackle. That's what I always imagine when I hear them. They sound like they're laughing. Well done, Andrew. A for effort and success. And while we go and check up on where leopard tracks ended up, let's pop over to Brent and find out what he's been up to.
Old tracks in New York.
So we're back. I bumped into Steph, and he said there was sign of elephant around this area. So we've come have a look. We're going to go head down now towards the southern boundary. But it is a wonderful green afternoon. It's almost bright in comparison. And remember, not even a week ago, a lot of these bush willows around us were turning orange already, and a little bit of rain, and they started to go green again. So I know a lot of you wonder about Karula, and I haven't heard anything from her. Now, there we go. So the bird list, the person to beat is Mike in Florida, who's on 220. Khada's on 132. Speaking of birds, just saw a raptor flying to the top of that tree. I can't see which raptor it is.
Oh, there you guys.
Oh, come on. Oh, can't see its tail. And Maggie's on 131 birds. Well, you guys are all beating me at the moment. I think I'm on about 20 on the live drive since I started counting. So I've got a lot of catching up to do. So the rule is I have to be able to show them to you. So we have to have them on the camera. And Tom in Dallas, Texas is on 70 species in 51 days. So I've got a lot of catching up to do. You guys are way ahead of me. Yeah, that very similar call, probably another golden-breasted bunting calling. Kansas says she's got a list that she opens up on a computer for every drive, keeps track of which presenter, the date, which cameraman, what we see, and she's on 81 species so far this year. That's very good going, Brandy. Hopefully we're going to be able to add a few more, and definitely while we have the pea shooter, as Scott likes to call it, which has the powerful super zoom. And doom. So we can focus in on the little LBJs and sometimes more difficult. See, the Ellies have been here. They've had a good fun play in this little mud wallow here. There's tracks everywhere. So we're in the right neck of the woods to look for elephants. Now, where did they go to next is the question. And James Richard says he's on 101, but 102 would be better. I agree with you there, James, and see what we can do. Well, I know it's one that most people have, but I don't have it on my live bird list so far. A bird we do see a lot. And it happens to be sitting in one of my favorite trees. And it's a brown ivory tree. And I'm waiting for the fruit to come along and I can have some snacks. But there we go, a forked-tailed drongo. One of our more common little birds we see often hawking around animals, picking up on insects disturbed by all manner of wildlife, even sometimes following our cars to try to catch any insect disturbed by us. A wonderful big brown ivory tree. So look at that, actually Tibbs. In the fork of that brown ivory tree, it looks like there's a come down right at the lowest fork. Down, 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 there we go. It looks like, let's have a look once we zoom in and look at the leaves. Yep, it looks like there's a baby ivory growing in the fork of that ivory. So what often happens in those forks of trees with wind and that, there's dust and dirt that'll build up. And then obviously brown ivory trees are, the fruit is highly sought out by a lot of birds. And they've then gone defecated in that little hollow, and now there's a baby ivory growing there. So we get two species of ivory in the Sabi Sands, the brown ivory and the red ivory. Both are delicious. In Zambia, they make quite a seriously strong moonshine out of brown ivory, enough to put hair on anyone's chest. I've had it once, and once was enough for me, called Kichaso. Very dangerous stuff. Sometimes said to be brewed with battery acid even. But also, on a nicer note, they use lots of preserves, like very nice marmalade and jam can be made. Virginia Beach, welcome Eric. Would like to know, are there any plants here that sort of are predatory like the Venus flytrap? Not to the same degree. You do have certain flower species, the carrion flowers. I don't have my flower book with me today, but they actually smell like rotting vegetation or rotting flesh, and they bring in flies, and they've got a very sort of viscous fluid that the insects go into, and then they digest them through that fluid. So there is one or two, but not that common. Oh, there we go. Neil, tapping me on the shoulder, has spotted an elephant. So we were definitely in the right zone for some ellies. Where do you want? There, hold it. There we go. There we go. Lovely Eddie, we actually think I've seen him before, but where are the rest of the herd? So if we listen quietly, quite often you can hear the elephants spread out. They do spread out when they're feeding like this, and they can often be 200-300 meters apart. Do love the smell of elephants. You can see how they just walk through that monkey orange, which would literally scratch us to pieces. And she flaps her ears, you can see all the veins behind the ears. And an elephant can have up to about 8 liters of blood between both sets of ears. And it's their air conditioning system, which enables them to be active in the heat of the day. And so by flapping their ears, they cool that blood and then pump the cool blood to the rest of the body, and obviously it just keeps flowing through. So you can see her flapping her ears, just cooling. And often people wonder where the ear hole is, and there we can see it. And you can see there's a lot of mud on her from cooling down and spraying. There we go, nice tabs. And obviously it wouldn't make any sense if the hole for the ear was behind. So with it being there, they've got that large radar dish. So not only does it act as the air conditioning system, it acts as a sound collector as well. So it increases their hearing. And elephants communicate quite often in decibels that we can't hear. And for any of our viewers out there who are movie buffs and have watched movies like Predator and Jurassic Park, almost 80 to 90% of all the alien and dinosaur noises in those movies are slowed down elephant sounds. They do have a huge range of vocal capabilities. But I'm just going to move on a little bit to see possibly if there aren't some more. And this Ellie, unfortunately, is on the wrong side of the road, so to speak. I'm hoping there might be some more in a bit more open area on the right side of the road. We had a wonderful time. We had some really monster big eddy bulls. Oh, what did it have? There's a Wahlberg's eagle just came off the ground and disturbed it. I don't know if it's got a kill here. Let's have a quick look. It landed quite close by, so let's have a look from the other side. Oh no, you know what it is. There we go. So if we look here, I'll try to find exactly where the... Okay, there we go. Okay, so Tebs, you see that? Okay. Okay, let me just try to find on this monitor if we come out. Okay, we got the stick here. Okay, so drop down a little bit. There we go. Okay. Zoom in slowly. There we go. Okay, there we go. Right in there. So that little bit of rain has caused the termites to release their alates. So they're drones and the future drones and queens. So if we, oh, there we go. We're gonna punch right in there. Look at that. So look at that, there we go. So the ones taking off, the flying ants, are the future kings and queens of the next termite generation. And these are Micromyces termites. They don't build those really big termite mounds. Look at that, isn't that fascinating? So now those flying ants that are taking off are almost all protein and really, really tasty. So many different animals in the bush will take advantage of that. Even predatory birds, I've seen leopards eat them, I've seen lions eat them, hyenas, wild dogs. And there we go, isn't that incredible? See how they're pushing, struggling to get out, being pushed out by the workers. And we notice that these workers are very, very white in comparison to like a harvester termite, which we see from time to time, which are much darker. They've got sort of dark stripes on them. And the reason that for this is that these guys very, very seldom venture out during the daylight. These workers, they get damaged, they get sunburned very easily. But the harvester termites that are active during the day foraging have got that melanin in their skin that enables them to operate during the day. And there we go, isn't that wonderful? Well, let's move on and let the Wahlberg's come back to its feast. And hopefully find some more elephants. So, now we're looking at those termites there, and the one book I do have with me, really interesting, is my insect book. And especially after the rain, I knew there were going to be some really interesting insects out. And there's a... where is it now? So there's a very specialist type of insect. I'm going to find you a picture of it now, called an African thief ant. And they look very similar to a driver ant, except they are black. And I'm just going to see if I can... I'm going to skid off the main drag, so in case there's other traffic, and then I'm going to grab it for you. So their workers are so tiny, they're barely visible with the human eye. And they are specialists at raiding termites. So an African thief ant will make a nest on the edge of a termite mound. And the workers are so small that they are able to go into the termite mound and carry out termite eggs to feed on without the termites even noticing. They are tiny. And how they disperse, like those flying ants we've just seen dispersing, is they will actually take off. But the big difference, to start their new colony when they take off, they can have up to 2,000 of these incredibly minute workers on their bodies as they fly off to set up shop at a new termite mound. So I'm just going to stop here. I was hoping there might be something around this little pad. But alas, as such luck, stuck in the shade here. African thief ant. See, we might be able to, with this camera, to show you on the picture those tiny little guys. Must be under T, thief ant. No, velvet ants. And it'll be driver ants. Ants. Oh, there we go, just ants we're gonna have to deal with. I should be able to spot him quite quickly. Wasps. No, we don't want wasps. We don't want robber flies. Here we go. There we go. How's that? So there's an African thief ant. They're quite big, about 25 millimeters long. The queens and the drones are also quite big. But there we can see, if we zoom in, so these tiny workers, sometimes hundreds and thousands of them will catch a lift on the adult as they go off to set up their new life. So isn't that incredible? And they only feed off termites. And generally we only see them on the first heavy rains of the summer. So you don't see them that often, and quite often no one really knows what they're looking at. So they're just sort of, oh, there goes a big black flying thing that's landed in my dinner. Off you scatter. Meanwhile, you've probably eaten a few hundred little workers if it's landed in your dinner. So unfortunately, the majority of those elephant tracks cross out of our traverse zone, but for every track that crosses out, one has to cross in at some point. So we're going to go pop down towards one of my favorite spots on Juma at the moment, the treehouse waterhole, which is the only natural seep. So after this rain, I want to see how full the seep is, and also a great spot to see all the bugs and insects as they come down to collect mud or drink water at that little seep. So I'm going to keep you honest with the birds on the Sunset Safari, and we will definitely have another bird quiz or two. But while we head down towards the treehouse waterhole, Jamie has got...
Here we go. Now, the tricky track quiz. Or, as I like to call it, as has suddenly popped into my head, the tricky track test. Aha, try saying that five times fast. What made these? I'm gonna let you guys guess, but I'm gonna hop out because you can't see them from above as clearly as I can. So I'm just gonna hop out and show you exactly what it is that we're looking at. I need a track stick. Here's a good track stick. Here's a good track stick. So, looking down at these, you see these ones clearly, Andrew?
Yeah, boy.
I don't get my shadow in the way. I'm going to tell you a couple of things, and for regular viewers, this might actually give it away. The back pad of this little paw print is asymmetrical, right? So that's your first big clue. These little things here are the toes, 1, 2, 3, 4. It looks slightly bigger because it's actually imprinted when the sand was wet, and there are claws that extend out. Now there's a couple of options, but there's one that I want. There's only one answer I will accept. That is the correct one. And look at the stride. Look at the distance here from this track to the start of the next track. That's roughly how long that body is. What could it be? What could it be? And it's important. Why is stuff like this important? Why is looking at little tracks like this, a little animal that we're never going to manage to track, we won't be able to follow it, these are oldish tracks. Why is it important to know what track you're looking at for little creatures? And the answer to that, or one of the big answers to that, apart from just interest in the way that they are and the way that they operate, is the fact that we know about their behavior. So, if for example, this were a nocturnal creature, tracks over a set of leopard traps. You immediately have not a perfect aging device, but at least a substantial one in terms of figuring out how old the animal is that you are trying to track. So that's one of them. Also, just sheer fascination. Which animal it is, how it walks, how long its strides it takes. Always interesting to follow up on the different tracks. Let's see if you can guess this one. I think I have asked this before, I'm not sure. But new viewers, it might even be... I'm not going to say it because it will give it away. I want to see if you can guess what it might be. Sorry. I've just heard leopard calling around Twin Dams, where we were a bit earlier. I know Brent's making his way there as well. It sounds like Brent's making his way there. I'm going to stick around close to the area just in case. But I'm not going to go in because there's three vehicles already moving around close to that spot. And perhaps, I'm not sure if Brent heard my update about the hippo wandering into that drainage line, but perhaps FC, if you could kindly just pass that message on to him again, that'd be great. Awesome. Thank you very much, Kirsty. Kirsty's on it. She's organized. That's where our leopard's gone. We were looking in the right place. It just tricked us. Mysteriously, somehow managed to get past us. Oh, that's so one of those frustrating things. If we'd been there 2 seconds, or no, that's not true, about 15 minutes later, we would have heard those calls. But this is good news, it means we've got a chance. Unfortunately, we're not going to have a chance to see the warthog I was trying to show you, except for disappearing little tails and bottoms. Well done, Andrew. Actually, our cameramen are always on point when it comes to warthogs because we know that generally they tend to run away. That's what makes those long warthog sightings that we've been having recently so special. Hey, Mbala, where's that leopard? And yet so far. Now a little bit earlier, the socially awkward girl wanted, and I'm not being horrible, that is her username. She wanted me to show her a giraffe. And Amir, who is watching in Miss Rosie's class, you were wondering how tall a giraffe can get. And the answer is easily up to 5 or so meters, the tallest male. And to put that into feet is about 15 feet at the top of its head. So very tall, obviously the tallest land animal that we have in the world, and an extraordinary thing to look at. I don't know, I always find the giraffes start looking a little bit odd. If you stare at them for too long, you're suddenly so aware of what strange creatures they are. I'm just going to be quiet for a little moment, just while we go through a bad signal patch. Seems to be okay though. Sticks flying everywhere, leopard chases on, the excitement's building. Are we going to find this leopard and who is it? I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to make my way south all the way and see if we can't work our way upwards. We're racing to see one of everybody's favorite animals, the incredibly attack of the gremlins, the bad signal patch on the road. Brent disappeared, I disappeared. It was just a brief moment of both of us vanishing, but luckily we're back up and running, thank goodness. And we seem to be stable again. Sorry about that, but it is one of those things, because we are live, we just know occasionally that it is going to happen. There are occasional signal black holes on the reserve, and we can't always avoid them, especially when we're racing to try and help follow up to find an animal. So forgive us for the minor technical disruption that just attacked us. Now, before that happened, I was in the middle of talking about Declan's question. And Declan, you wanted to know what my favorite cat is. It's a really hard one. Leopards, of course, are always extraordinary to see. Cheetah, especially because we hardly ever see them, is always an exciting moment. They tend to hang out around Biffles Hook and Torchwood. But I think if I had to choose, and I'm assuming you mean from this area that we could see, and not one of the other cats of the world, because there's some incredibly attractive cats. There's the snow leopard and the ocelots and the clouded leopards of the world, which are all so beautiful and fascinating. But for this area, I think my favorite would be a serval. A serval is a medium-sized cat. Looks a little bit like somebody shrunk a cheetah. And it's got incredibly powerful limbs, capable of springing up and catching birds in midair. We race to make our way towards the area that leopard was heard calling in. Let's pop over to Brent, who actually has a warthog to show you.
Okay, copy.
There we go. One of the cutest little creatures out here, off that jog. And also one of the tastiest, if you ask, the leopard. So we just got a report that there was a leopard calling somewhere in this area. So Scotty's out tracking, and we've come into this area. So we just listen for a second. And it's unusual for a leopard to call at this time of the day, normally closer to sunset. But if a female is in the mood for love, they can be very vocal. And female leopards will often actually move well out of their territory to mates, even 2-3 territories over. And what they do is they mate with any possible male whom they might come across with their cubs, and basically trying to convince everyone that they're the daddy. So not only are we listening for that distinct and rasping call of a leopard, we're also listening to see if a squirrel or a monkey or a kudu or nyala have spotted them for alarm calls. So always important, and quite often in the bush your ears will find your animals long before your eyes do. Anyway, let's carry on. And we're on Leadwood Road, and it takes its name from this large dead leadwood tree. Isn't that spectacular? And they can often stay standing for well over 100 years after they've died. They are very termite resistant, so the termites can't eat that wood. So this is the area where we have been seeing quarantine at Kanuma occasionally, so fingers crossed. One of our favorite regular viewers. Hello, Gracie. For those who don't know, Gracie's 8 years old and she's only got 19 birds. And she says, I only watch the morning safaris because I'm asleep for the other one. Is that okay? Gracie, I think there are very few 8-year olds who've got a list of 19 birds. So I think you're winning there, Gracie. Well done to you. Keep watching and I'll try and find your favorite bird, your cinnamon bun bird, or a cinnamon breasted bunting. We will have a look for that. I know that's your favorite bird. And Gracie, maybe we've got another bird for your list, not right now. I'm going to try and see if we can spot it. It's definitely a new one for my live safari list. There it is. There's two of them there. They're often in pairs and they're very, very mobile. They're sometimes quite difficult to get on the camera. You've got them there. It's usually flown already. There it goes. Disappearing. All right. Well, I guess you'll try to find it again for you there, but it was a southern black tit. And they make lots of very noisy little birds. But the noisiest bird in the bush, I heard one calling now. Oh, and there's a very nice bird for a lot of you. Let me just get forward. I'm sure this will add to quite a few people's lists. Okay, so there we go. To the left-hand tree. Left, and just jump to the right, jump to the right. Okay, zoom, there we go. There we go, beautiful. That's a beautiful little bird. There we go, nice work, Tebs. And that is a common scimitable. And when you can see it's always... probe into holes and in between the tree and the bark. Oh, pop down. And there we go, a common scimitable. Very, very cool little bird. And he's now disappeared into that thicket, but Tebs is on it. There you go, coming back up. And you can see that scimitar-shaped bill. So they're able to insert that into little holes and actually into little gaps in the bark and get different bugs and things out of there to feed on. So, Gracie, I hope that's number 19 for you. Common scimitar bill. And there's the others that I was trying to show earlier, too, if we go straight into that there. There we go. There it is. There's the southern black tit. Whoop. And so they're quite busy little birds, often hopping around, which makes them one of the more challenging ones to get on camera. And you hear that. You hear them more often than you get a good view of them. And you see completely black with the white wings. Busy little guys. So stopping and having a look at the birds also gives us a chance to listen. And again, listening in case there's an alarm call and there's a leopard around. So there we go, Gracie. I think that should be 20. Scotty is trying to get hold of me. Scott.
Brent, just to update you, I spoke with Peter, and he was around the concrete crossing on Central when he heard the animal calling down in the Malawi. I'm going to just walk upstream to Spaghetti Junction.
All right, copy. I'll do Ledwood and then I'll do Mumbai.
Copy, and it sounds like it should be further upstream from there, from this
upstream. Copy, thanks, Scotty. So, Scotty too hot, he's on the track. And he's gonna go have a walk in that little riverbed, the Mawati, see if he can find any of those leopard tracks. So, fingers crossed, guys. So this is one of my favorite roads on Juma, and because it doesn't get driven sometimes as often as the other roads, and there's this wonderful myriad of drainage systems that are great to walk through. And when I have done some of the live walks, this is my sort of favorite area to walk to. It's my go-to area in and around these drainage systems. So, a common one, but I know a firm favorite with the viewers. Please sit for long enough. One of the more beautiful birds with that sort of electric blue coloration. A little bit to the right, I think. No. Where's he gone? Oh, I've lost sight of him. There we go. Woodlands kingfisher. So, an insectivorous kingfisher. So Peter, who's in Belito on the KwaZulu-Natal North Coast, was wondering if we still see woodlands. There we go. There are actually a few more around than there were in the last couple of weeks. So I know a lot of our regular viewers will know the answer to this, but let's just see if you've been listening to what I've been saying. And the Latin name for woodlands kingfisher is Halicon senegalensis. Senegalensis, it was probably first described from the area around the Senegal River. But the Halicon part is actually an old Italian word. And who can remember how and why kingfishers of this nature have got that start to their Latin name, Halicon. And it's another old, very old English term about Halicon days. Let's see who can work it out from that. And remember, send your answers through by email to questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. Oh, fluff. Wonderful electric blue. And actually quite ferocious predators if you happen to be a frog or bug and spend a lot of time perched just like that, watching for any movement on the ground or around them. But let's continue to look for a kitty cat. So Annie's saying, since we're on birds today, and Annie's in British Columbia, she would like to know, what bird in South Africa builds the biggest tree nest? And how big is it? I think that would have to be the hammerkop, which is a small heron species, probably about this big. They build a nest that can probably weigh over 100 kilograms, so well over 200 pounds, and probably be as wide as we are here in this car, and probably just as deep. So as wide as a Land Rover, and probably as sometimes even deeper than that, and they will actually live in the center. But there we go, the noisiest bird in the African bush have all flown away. Well, sure, we'll catch up with another one. Also one of our more common species, our more common LBJs, little brown jobs. And we'll get a view of one now as we come around the corner. And yeah, them zip, zip, zip. Okay, there's quite a little bird party here. So let's start. Which one have you got there? There we go, that's the noisy one. The rattling cisticula. Zip, zip, zip. And if we come out from the rattling cisticula, there's a more interesting bird slightly. And we come across to the left. I mean, to the right, sorry, that's my fault. And is that him there? Ah, he's flown off. There was a little flycatcher who's disappeared. That's another rattling cisticula. What is a flycatcher? Where did he go? He's flown off. Anyway, looks like we're causing a traffic jam here. I didn't think there'd be anyone else on this road, so we're going to continue on. There we go, a rattling cisticula. My old Shangan tracker, Mr. Matabula. Simon used to say, it always sounds like they say, kiss, kiss, run away, kiss, kiss, run away. And that would generally be followed on by a very deep laugh Mr. Matabula had. quite the character. He used to scare the absolute daylights out of new staff members. You would get a new camp manager arriving from Johannesburg, Durban, some other city, into hotel school. And now they come out to the bush, and we arrive, and they're sort of running around the deck, being very helpful and friendly and smiley. And I'd introduce them to my tracker. I would say, "This is Simon." And they'd go, "Hi, Simon." And Simon would go, "No, it's Mr. Matabula." And these poor little girls used to be living fear of him for about the first couple of weeks until they realized he was joking. So every new one he used to give the gears to and then wander off as soon as they couldn't see him going, "Oh, oh, 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 oh." So a big warm safari live welcome to Ashley Rose's class. You are doing 3D computer something. I'm not a computer person, but this is definitely a good way to spend a school lesson. Joining us, computer science. Their classroom's called 3D, but they're doing computer science. Well, this is definitely a great way to spend a computer science lesson. I think the very few computer science lessons I attended, I ended up not doing much computer science work. But a really big welcome, and lovely to have you guys on the back of the vehicle with us. And obviously, of course, without computer scientists, like our tech gurus, we wouldn't be able to bring you this live drive from the middle of the African bushveld to wherever your classroom might be in the world. And final control, I think they are very funny. Kirsten says, "Did I even have computers at school? Aren't I old?" Yeah, very funny, Kirsten. Yes, we did have computers. They were quite big. And with a really terrible computer science teacher. He used to scare the daylights out of us. So us bush children used to sort of try avoid the computer lab. Neil was another one. He's sitting behind me. You can hear him cackling. Because obviously we went to the same school. He knows about that computer teacher. And how the likes of us, it's probably the last place at school you would find us. Was in the computer lab. You're more than likely to find us climbing up a tree trying to look in a bird's nest. And that actually reminds me, so the school I went to was an all-boys boarding school, and it is attached to a sort of a wildlife reserve. It also has commercial farming, so it has a dairy farm, a piggery, some maize, some plantations, but it's also got a section that's set for wildlife, which is, I can't remember, probably about 600-700 hectares. It's about 700 hectares. And my grandparents actually used to live across the river. So we knew there were leopard in the area, but the teachers did not want to believe us. So I think I was 14, Neil must have been 15 or 16. And we took a car battery that is not a light thing. It probably, I don't know, weighs around 8-9 kilograms. And we put the car battery in a backpack and we attached a spotlight to it. Just wanted to check down Mumba Road, back and cross towards the Mwati in case that leopard is moving south. So we popped a car battery in it. There were three of us, and we basically walked that whole area at night with a spotlight to prove that we could find the leopard there. And we did. We also found bush pigs and lots of other different animals. We also found a very scary Zulu witch doctor the one night, and I think none of us slept that night around the fire. We sat there with machetes, one thinking we were going to be bewitched. But yeah, we had that was one of the wonderful things about the school we went to, is the fact people like Neil and I, we don't really like school, but the fact that we were able to escape onto this wonderful reserve that had fishing and animals and stuff where we could be very naughty, far far from the eyes of a teacher. I think if a teacher wanted to find us on the weekends, he would have had a big struggle. Ashley Rose's 3D classes. Thanks for the shout out. My pleasure, guys. And hopefully, you know, you don't have to be in class to join us. You can join us whenever you want. If you've got a free moment, please jump on the back of the vehicles with us. Dipping down towards that Mawati drainage, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to switch off the engine and I'm just going to slowly coast down the hill, and hopefully if there is anything alarm calling or that leopard decides to call again, we might bump into it. So a lot of tracking, especially when the ground's hard like it is at the moment, is what we would call educated guessing. So you got to sort of try, say, if I was a leopard, where would I go? Why would I go there? And as I said, unusual for a leopard to be calling in this heat. There's generally only two reasons. I said the female looking for a male to mate with. Otherwise, it's males, and there might be an ongoing territorial dispute. And I think more likely to be the female. The male leopards are quite set at the moment in their territories. And this is very much Tingana's territory now. Male impala looking far too relaxed. Yeah, off they go. I asked you where that first part of a woodland's kingfisher's scientific name comes from, the Halicon part. And yes, in Wisconsin, it's named after tragic lovers from a Greek myth. I didn't know that, Gilly, but from what my understanding is, a Halicon day is when the Mediterranean becomes flat and looks like a lake, and there's a relative of the woodlands and other Halicon kingfisher species that used to get confused and fly out into the ocean, would often land on ships or land in the sea and die. So from those Halicon days when the sea is completely still. But I'm definitely gonna have to go do some research on Greek mythology. Thanks for that, Kelly, giving me some homework to do. So while we head down, we might lose some signals. We go down into the Mawati here. We're gonna go across to Jamie to see what she's been up to.
Here's a Greek myth about woodlands kingfishers. I didn't know that either. That's very interesting. But what I'm doing at the moment is I'm sitting at the top of the Mawati drainage line, or at least the point at which there's a confluence between the drainage line from the dam and the Mawati itself. Now Scott is walking from close to where we saw the hippo. He does know about the hippo, by the way, before you worry. And he's walking slowly up towards us. So I've stopped for a while just to listen to see if there are any kind of alarm calls. And I wonder if the fact that this leopard spent the entire day from last night around this drainage line, if indeed it is the same leopard. Sorry, Franklin now calling. They've gone quiet again, so that wasn't an alarm call. There's a wide range of birds that are busy calling at the moment. You can hear the constant trill of a crested barbet. Now, I think I might have managed to catch you guys out on that particular quiz that I did a little bit earlier. So Raisa, Peter and David and a couple of others, you came the closest. You said it was a white-tailed mongoose. And I'm going to show you, I'm actually going to accept that as a possible right answer because of the way in which that track was pushed into the sand. You were absolutely right. Remember how I said it was an asymmetrical back pad? That immediately puts it into the mongoose family. The fact that it was on its own and that it was the size that it was gives you two options. One is a white-tailed, one is a water mongoose. I'm going to say that you guys got it right. I disagree, though. I think it's a water mongoose, but we might not be able to tell for sure because of the pattern in the sand. But just have a look at what the way that the toes splay out for a water mongoose. It's not unheard of for them to be around these areas. And also what made me think it might be a white-tailed is the distance between the track. A water mongoose, if I turn the page to show you what it looks like, water mongoose is actually quite a large creature with quite a long body. It's slightly longer than the white-tailed mongoose itself. But I will say that I will accept the answer white-tailed mongoose. For new viewers, you might not have seen them. They've been a bit shy because it's summer, which means it takes a while for everything to cool down in the afternoons and the evenings. They are nocturnal, just like the water mongoose is nocturnal. But the level at which the... You can see the tail there. So I'll accept white-tailed. I'm still not sure. I think it might have been a water mongoose. It'd be unlikely. I mean, sorry, not unlikely, unusual to see them come through this area, but they are here, and I have seen their tracks here before. But that level of splaying in the sand and the length of the claws, I suspect might make it a water mongoose. But we'll take white-tailed. So well done to you guys. I thought maybe I might have nearly caught you out with that one. Mongoose are always very interesting animals. And of course, the other thing is that when you look at the drawing of the tracks, drawings can never really fully convey exactly what that track looks like. It's quite difficult to capture on paper. That's why photographs are always a nice way. But again, with photographs, there's a difference in terms of substrate. So the type of soil or the type of mud the track is hidden in. Fairly close to Sydney's dam, and there could well be a water mongoose that lives there. They're territorial and they are solitary and they are nocturnal. Hello, Doidas. You're racing. I'm going to race across the road. Go, go, go. I love watching them. Something so fascinating about the way tortoises move. Run, run. Where are you going to go? Are you going to go across the road or are you going to go back off the road? Back off the road. What was the point in that, Mr. or Mrs.? Little leopard tortoise wandering through. Nice to see them out again. Surprisingly speedy for an animal with a reputation of being very slow. Always with slightly pigeon-toed feet. And since he kindly walked into the soft sand in the sun, I think that once he disappears from our view, we should go and have a look at the tracks he left behind, since we seem to be doing a track-themed day, as well as bird-themed. It's always important at this time of year to really watch where you're driving, particularly coming around a corner. You'll notice we drive nice and slowly, just to make sure that we don't encounter any of these little creatures on the road. But Rocky Knight, you were wondering, because we drive through those puddles, whether there could be any creatures in them. And watch the way that we all drive through. You'll notice we do it very slowly. And the reason for that is we do it very carefully. The reason for that is almost inevitably there is going to be a terrapin in there. Luckily, Either the mud is very, very soft within those water holes, or they surf. They are very, very skilled at getting out of the way. I have never once encountered a squashed terrapin on the road, except where it was clear someone was going too fast. I have never once found a dead terrapin or a squashed terrapin in a water pool. They see the wheels coming, and if you take it slowly, they can actually use it to surf out of your way. So we're very careful. Unfortunately, you cannot go round every single puddle. And the reason behind that is you actually start to create and expand the new roads. So you push the sides of the road out further and further and further. Why is that a bad thing, you might ask? Because, first of all, we don't want too many roads spoiling the natural area, but also because roads make for serious drainage systems. So what they do is, because there's nothing, the soil is compacted, so the water can't run through the soil, and there is no way for them to, or nowhere for the water to get past it. It essentially runs onto the road, and the underwater water table is disrupted. So that's why we don't drive around every puddle, but we do so very slowly, so that we don't squish any terrapins. I have never squished one personally, and I don't think any of the other guides have either. My shadow is going to make this very tricky, having a look at his tracks. Might be harder than I thought it was going to be at this angle. Sun's in exactly the wrong place. I don't want to stop for too long because I want to go and investigate the other side of the drainage line, see if maybe we can follow up on that leopard. I'll do leopard tracks, leopard tortoise tracks for you another time. See if I can catch you out of those. That was one thing we used to get tested on during our time learning to track, which was the difference between tortoise and terrapin tracks, which can actually be unbelievably difficult. Stretches all the way across the Mawati. I've driven over this dam wall three times this afternoon, but that doesn't mean I didn't miss the leopard hiding here, especially if it's now on the move and calling. What surprises me is that it called once and then not again, but keep your eye out for that giveaway white tail flash. Keep your eyes peeled so that I can focus on the dam wall and not drive Andrew and myself over the side of it. They're seeking here, they're seeking there. Here's another one of those water puddles. In this particular case, the road goes around, so we can dodge it. But I'll show you when we come down to the bottom of this dip. I'll have a look and I'll show you that there are almost guaranteed to be terrapins in there. I hope this isn't the one puddle without terrapins. There we go, there's one. There's two. Sorry, I put Andrew at a very difficult, awkward angle. There's one little terrapin head. There were two. Three, four, five. Well done, Andrew. Lots of terrapins, baby terrapins, tiny little terrapins, all hiding in the mud puddles. So that's why we go through so slowly. This road's slowly starting to come apart. But apart from the damage that it's done to the roads, as Tippy says, we've got so much green grass. And yes, Tippy, it's nice to see more green grass than we've seen in at least a month. It is such a pleasure and such a relief to see nice green shoots coming through. And of course, course, it hasn't been enough to fill up the dams, but it's certainly been a huge help in that respect.
Thank you.
Morning. I think this was my imagination. When you look too hard for a certain animal, you start to see it in everything. For example, Scott's sable in Yala. And in this case, my leopard log, which is somewhere in there that I saw. Leopard logs, leopard termite mounds. It's amazing how many things out here look like leopards but turn out not to be leopards. One day, the thing is, we know that this leopard is hiding in here somewhere. I wonder if it's Karula or if it's the male you saw last night crossing the Juma Dam. So this is where Scott's walking through. So we might spot a leopard, we might also spot Scott if he decides to come wandering. To chatted a lot about the different bird lists that people have been keeping. Genevieve has just sent through a message to say that she doesn't keep a bird list, but she does keep an insect and an arachnid list, and that she really enjoyed our bushwalk where we saw so many wonderful little creatures, some of which none of us actually knew what they were or even recognized. And in fact, chatting about it, some snails, certain species of snails, only come out once every 5 years. So it may have been a really nice opportunity to get to see it. But Genevieve, I agree with you. First of all, we've got some of the most stunning insects. Second of all, we've got very gifted cameramen with a lovely camera to get you up close and personal with them. And that is what makes the bushwalk so much fun. You get to see aspects of this area and the animals in this area that we don't necessarily see on drive or focus on drive. Although we've had quite a quiet bird-themed afternoon this afternoon, we know that this place is teeming with life all around us. So Genevieve, I'll make a concerted effort, and I'm sure the other presenters will too, to help you add to your insect and arachnid list. I'm not sure if you saw Brent's video, Genevieve, on the click beetle that we found last night. Absolutely fascinating. So it's a very large ground beetle that, by throwing its head back with incredible speed and power, causes that clicking sound. Have a look and see. I'm sure some of the viewers will be able to share it with you. You can have a look either on Facebook or I think you put it up on Twitter as well. You can just imagine how if you're a bird and you tried to catch it, how that sudden click motion combined with the strength of that beetle would actually really give you such a surprise that you could well be tricked into dropping it, even though it doesn't have anything other than sound and fury to go by. Although I did manage to break skin on my finger when I tried to grab it using its carapace, pinched it together in the carapace. I was very impressed. Very, very impressed. Come on, leopard. Kitty, kitty. You've mentioned the different visual cues that human beings and other animals give off in terms of helping you to determine their mood. And you're wondering if you can apply the same principle to big cats. And yes, you absolutely can, Darlene. There's a couple of things. The most important aspects of their body language are their ears and their tail. Now, just like with domestic pets, Darlene, I'm not sure if you have any either cats or dogs, but particularly the position of the ears. back like this is either aggressive or nervous, ears poked forward interested, flicking from side to side is relaxed but alert, and so on and so forth. And you combine that with the movements of the tail. With big cats, a thrashing tail is an angry cat. Although leopards in general don't seem to keep their tails very still, they've sort of always got that constant flicking motion, which I often wonder about because I've seen it give away a stalking leopard before. So I think just don't have that physical control over it. And that's actually why the backs of, for example, lions' ears are highlighted in black, because it helps to emphasize it to the other animals that they're trying to communicate with. Then, of course, there's the position of the lips, the snarl versus a relaxed look. Sometimes dogs, they even submissively grin, like with wild dogs. And then body language. So shoulders crouched down, slumped, slinking, gives off a different message to just walking. And it's watch. All guides, and I'm sure the other presenters will say exactly the same thing. All of us as guides, whenever we're in a sighting, even though we've seen that animal hundreds of times before, that particular individual, we're always watching to see its body language. And it's a way of knowing how to judge distance that you are from the animal and the level of comfort that it has with the animal. And it's very important because they're wild animals. And it's important to be watching the messages and reading the messages that they are sending you and to each other, both to interpret what's happening in their lives, but also to keep everybody and the animals safe. So yes, you can read big cat's body language, and if you keep watching the show, you'll actually learn along with us how to read the different animals' body languages, especially for something like a big elephant. While we do one more search up the Mawati drainage line and see if we can catch up with Mr. Scott, I'm going to send you back over to Brent so we can update you from his side.
So no luck with that leopard. I know Scotty's on foot in the area still checking. So we've moved off towards the eastern boundary. We're now heading north and we're going to jump onto that sort of officer cut line, the road that leads into infinity, it almost looks like. It just stretches out of this undulating bushveld. And I'm hoping we might find some elephants if we head to the northwestern corner. It's got a bit warmer. It's those very big elephant trails that are used frequently. Amazing how green it goes so quickly after a little bit of rain. So just an update on all the lions out and about. So the five Birminghams are to the east of us. Five Birminghams is to the east of us. Hopefully, fingers crossed, they come west overnight. And then the Salati males and the Talamati pride are to the north of us. Quite far to the north, actually, probably about as far away from us as they can get from this Buffalo cut line. I still have never seen the Talamati pride. I'm hoping that they do decide to come visit one day. They've got 8 cubs at the moment, but they're probably not going to come close to us because of the Birmingham boys. And then the Nkuhumas are fat and happy on a buffalo kill in Sibambili, and hopefully they'll finish that up in the next while and decide to come visit us. Sitting in Sandton in Johannesburg in a high-rise building, but he has managed to sneak out on safari this afternoon. Mike is wondering when we're going to get lion cubs from the Nkuhumas. They have been mating with those Birmingham boys. So Mike, I think from the first mating with the Birmingham boy, it was probably a month or so ago. So carrying on another 3 months, I'd say. So what are we now? January, February, March, April, May, June, July. I would say July at the earliest, more than likely August, September. So lionesses have an inbuilt system to protect their cubs. So what happens when a coalition takeover happens, like it's happened now, the females will come into a false estrus. And they will mate with the males, but it is to convince the males that they have now succumbed to their masculine charms. And which way are these Ellie trains going? The wrong way, unfortunately. So they will mate with the males, but that first set of mating almost never, I wouldn't say never, but almost never produces cubs. Then the next set of the estrus cycles in about 3 months' time after that is when they will actually probably become impregnated. The reason for this is that in case the Birmingham boys get chased away by another group in that first sort of 6 months, they've got a little bit of backup, so they don't have new cubs that get killed again. And obviously producing cubs can take quite a lot of, put quite a lot of strain and pressure on a lioness. So she needs to know that it's worth producing those and they've got a good chance of survival due to the male lions in the area being settled. Leopards do a very almost the exact same thing as well when new males come into an area. Front. So I wonder what leopard that could have been calling. Hopefully Scotty gets some luck out there on foot. As I hear that, I hear Scotty say no joy. Scott is on foot. How would he handle the situation if he came across a leopard? I would probably think with a sort of fist pump and then onto the radio to call us in. A leopard on foot is a different animal, so you behave differently with different animals on foot. So with leopard, quite often when you're tracking them, you can actually see them, so often you see them from quite close. The leopard's main form of defense is camouflage. So you basically look at the leopard and then sort of look away, pretend you haven't seen it, walk along and then go back and fetch your car and drive it. Lion, on the other hand, is something you probably keep your eye on, although 99% of the time the lions run away from you on foot during the day. And the biggest threat to us on foot is an old buffalo bull that we surprise in a thicket. Like that hippo you saw with Jamie today. Those are possibly two of the biggest dangers. And of course, the elephants just being so big, but fortunately, all of us have spent a lot of time on foot, and we're not too worried about bumping into any of the animals while we're out there. Wondering at what age do leopards stop growing. Guys, I am going down a hill towards a little river system, so you might lose me for a few seconds, but I'll pop up the other side. But Paul, as we make our way down there, male leopards are probably fully grown, finished at about six, and females maybe a little bit younger, five or so. So we're going through a bit of a bad signal area while we try to get towards where I'm hoping there are going to be some elephants. So while we do that, let's jump on board with Jamie.
While you were with Brent, Scott and I have been chatting, and that leopard continues to evade us. He's walked all along the drainage line, not had any luck. He hasn't bumped it by any by sheer luck, and he hasn't heard it call either. And no tracks to follow up upon. So this leopard remains a mystery to us both. I've decided to readjust my route. I wonder whether or not that leopard might decide to go and have a drink. Keep your eyes on the Duva Dam camera as well. Because if it is that leopard from yesterday and he does have a kill from last night, then he's going to be coming through for a bit of a quick drink. Although he could utilize, I wouldn't be surprised if he utilizes those puddles that we stopped and looked at the terrapin in. You never know. And on the subject of that puddle with the terrapins, just to let you guys know, I apologize for not seeing the monitor lizard that was with them. It was not a baby crocodile, it was a monitor lizard. Hello. Hello, boy. Arjen, in the Netherlands, you were wondering about it, and you said you saw a baby crocodile. It was that monitor lizard that lives around the dam, which we're fairly certain is a water monitor. Hello, zebra. It's this lone male again. Now, apparently this morning you saw a zebra that was lying down fast asleep on the grass. I wonder why this gentleman's all on his own, but he does look incredible in this evening light. Not that uncommon to see males on their own, though. They usually do prefer the safety of bachelor groups. He might be deciding to make a play for his first female. He's a big gentleman. Very striking stripes. Lots of black on this particular zebra, which sounds like the most ridiculous thing to say. Look at that stripe pattern. How cool is that? Little circles in his leg there. You can see what I mean when I say he's got lots of black. Those black stripes are really thick. And of course, each zebra pattern is unique to that particular zebra, as unique as a leopard's spot patterns or our fingerprints are to each individual. He's mowing his patch of lawn. Hello, boy. What did you hear? Zebra is much less selective about the grass that they eat. Now, we are still looking for that mysterious sable, and I know that James Richard, you were wondering if anybody spotted it in the surrounding areas, or if there's a possibility it's still on Juma. It's got very interesting stripe patterns when we look at him closely, the zebra. James, nobody's reported the sable. Is it possible he is still on Juma? I guess so, yes, anything's possible. But I would say that it is unlikely. So sable walk easily 20 kilometers in a night, looking for access to water. And it's also not that uncommon for particularly lone males to wander enormous distances. But the fact that a sable did show up for the first time in over 17 years on the Juma Dam camera is a very exciting prospect. And I wouldn't say that it's impossible that he might come back as well. Now that he's discovered that there's water there, I wouldn't be at all surprised if that were the case. As it is for now, I have decided to rename the Nyala that lives at Inga's. I've decided to rename it Sable. It was called Fricky. It's now called Sable. Now, each animal carries its own unique sense, or scent. And Susie, you were wondering if zebras smell like horses. And yes, they do. They smell very, very similar to horses, with a slight more dusty scent, maybe, if I could describe it like that. Something that is uniquely African about it. But yes, they mainly smell like horses, and those large round tummies are, of course, caused by expanded by the gases produced in their intestines during the digestion of the grass. And that, in turn, produces heavy amounts of gas that quite often exit the zebra, particularly when it's moving rapidly. I must say, the explosive sounds as the zebra trot away from you can be absolutely hilarious and has entertained many of the children guests that I've had. And Miss Lobo Bob, you were saying that you think zebras are awesome, and you were wondering if I saw that article that scientists are now thinking that stripes are not just for camouflage. And I did, and I've actually said it all along on these live drives, that I don't necessarily believe that it's purely about disruptive coloration to break up the outline, although that is one factor. And I've always said, if stripes are such a perfect camouflage tool, why are zebra the only ones that have them? That's something that I've considered. So we've also talked about the different reasons that the article puts forward as possibilities. But how cool is that? The fact that we can sit with a zebra and suddenly rethink everything we ever knew and go, hey guys, why do they have stripes? And we're just not entirely sure. So one of the possible explanations is thermoregulation. So essentially, the black stripes absorb heat faster than the white stripes, that's how the theory goes, and thus that makes little microcurrents of air, and you can see how that would work in terms of the zebra's coloration. So it in turn produces air movement, which would flow across the skin. The other explanation is that it exists as, wow, this is so beautiful. The other reason that exists is the possibility that it disrupts the vision of the various, for example, stable flies, horse flies, anything that carries possible diseases or acts as an irritant for the zebra. So it's thought that the stripes maybe confuse their eyesight and thus make landing on it harder. If you combine that with that perfect tail whip or fly swatter, that is that furry tail, you can see why it might act as a perfect deterrent to keep flies at bay or insects at bay. Hey boy, what do you think? Why are you stripy? How cool is that, that we just don't know? Now, I've only ever been in close proximity to a zebra once that was a wild but anesthetized zebra. And Zoe, you were wondering what their fur feels like. It does feel a lot like a horse, just a little bit coarser than your average domestic horse breed, which tends to be silkier. Zebra are a bit rougher, but it does feel a lot like a horse, particularly around behind the ears and the smooth skin of the neck. I wonder if he's contemplating his existence now. Who am I? Why am I stripy? Do I smell like a horse? Nope, he's far more interested in dinner. It's beautiful to see him in this afternoon light, and some wonderful questions that have been raised about everything we know about zebras, much like the question that we've raised about the giraffe and why they have long necks. And it's only in the last few years that scientists have started to rethink the explanation that it's just to help them eat higher leaves. And in fact is probably a reproductive tool, or being able to use those long necks as weapons for males to fight each other. Interesting. It's one of the things I love about being out here, is that you just never know why exactly something is the way it is. You can only guess at it. And as our lone zebra starts to wander off into the sunset and head to find the beginnings of a new herd, I believe that Brent has found another one of our sociable animals.
So we've come across a little breeding herd of buffalo, I'd guess probably 100 or so. and I didn't see a cow I recognized who's got a single horn. And it's just slowly moving through the bush here. I'm gonna move forward a little bit now, see if we can get a better look at some of them. Unfortunately, the majority of them mobile into Buffalo's Hook. Younger and an older bull here on the periphery. You can see the main difference there. And the one on the left, you can still see there's some hair between the horns. His boss isn't quite hard yet. It hasn't become that rock solid piece of matted hair like the other one. And he's now hiding behind. And you can see, here we go. You can see more mature. Doesn't have that soft boss. You see it, bulk grazers as they move through, taking advantage of this little green flush we've had after the rain. Really important. And they turn over a lot of ground with their hooves, especially when they get chased by lions. So that really sort of tills the soil, so to speak. And also, of course, they're great fertilizers as they go. So your one-stop gardening shop, preferably around 1,000 buffalo in a group. So Pamela would like to know, what was my favorite animal in the bush as a child? Oh, Pamela, it's the same animal that's my favorite in the bush as an adult. It is the African wild dogs. I do love them dearly. And so much excitement when I see them. I tend to start behaving like, a bit like a wild dog. I do like most of the animals I love. I do have a special affinity for all the predators. And bushbuck, strange enough, is my favorite antelope. Mrs. Bob is wondering about wild dogs. How did they get here? Are they a descendant of the domestic hound? Or are they a naturally occurring wild animal? Well, we're gonna leave these buffalo. I'm gonna keep heading, see, hopefully we can find some elephant as they sort of move further off into Buffalo's Hook. Well, they are, you could say that they are relatives of the dog. They are canid. But they separated from the domestic dog many, many moons ago, probably well over a million years ago. They even have an extra toe that the domestic dog doesn't have. And if you look at their scientific name, a domestic dog is a canis, where there is a wild dog is a lichen. We call lichen pictus, the painted wolf is the direct translation of that, or actually wolf painted, if you want to be pedantic. But so they're not a direct relation to domestic. They cannot cross breed with domestic dogs, unlike something like a wolf, which can cross. So there's very actually little difference in DNA between a wolf and a domestic dog, and there's almost zero difference between a chihuahua and a Great Dane. Those dogs have been bred by humans into those shapes and forms. Good. Wild dogs also, their dental structure is quite different from your domestic dog. Obviously feeding almost exclusively on meat and fresh meat at that. They very seldom scavenge. So their dentition has changed, and obviously their teeth have developed more from ripping and tearing rather than chewing bones. listening to the radio there. I thought Scott might have an update for us. He doesn't. Doing bird lists, and one of our favorites, Gracie, who's 8 years old, who was on 18 birds, and she was wondering if this was sufficient. And I said to Gracie, I doubt there's any other 8-year-old who's got such an impressive bird list. And she just said she already had the southern black tit as number 7 on her bird list, but she's now encouraging her grandmother to start a bird list, and she's told her that the southern black tit must be number 1 on her list. So I think Gracie, after that scimitar bull, I'm hoping you are 19 today, and we'll see what else we can find. So I do have an interesting little toy that I've brought along with me today, and I'm going to pop out somewhere in the bush and collect it after the morning safari tomorrow. There we go. It's a trail camera, and we're going to pop it up. It takes videos and pictures, and we're going to pop it up in an area where we think there might be something interesting moving around. I'm thinking maybe around Zoe's Road, see if we can catch the serval on camera. Wouldn't that be fantastic? But we'll have to wait till after the sunrise safari, and we will see what's out there tomorrow. And I know that Jamie's favorite cat is a serval, so hopefully we get to find and get a video of that serval that we've seen a few times on the drives around Zoe's Road. Raisa says, well, maybe the wild dogs start behaving like Brent rather than vice versa when they see him. Well, I hope I have that much of an effect on them. I doubt it, though. I think they're far more interested in filling their bellies with baby impala. But it would be nice for them to make an appearance this week. So at the moment now that the puppies are sort of about 7 months old now, and they have been mobile with the pack for quite a while, they start extending into a much bigger home range now, with the puppies being able to hunt and carry on with them. So hopefully they do decide to spend a bit more time on Juma. Andy and Julia, who are from the City of Angels, I said the other day we were watching a bird peck at an open wound on a buffalo. Well, that is an oxpecker, more than likely a red-billed oxpecker, if you're lucky. Oh, well-spotted Neil. Oh, okay, here we go. Oh, it's going to fly. Ah, and it is one we haven't seen today. A lesser-spotted eagle. We just saw those white spots as it took off, much bigger than a Warburg's. Nice camera work, Tebs. You see that little white in the back as well as it disappears is another distinguishing feature of the lesser spotted eagle. So that's actually quite a nice one for the bird lists. We don't see them that often. Well spotted Neil. Of course, I'm busy yapping away, not looking around. So it's quite nice having Neil in the back. He can do half the work for me. But we're chatting about that oxpecker. I said more than likely a red-billed oxpecker. If you were lucky, which we do see from time to time, it was a yellow-billed oxpecker pecking at that open wound on a buffalo. And they'd like to know whether this is good or bad for the buffalo. Well, it's not comfortable for the buffalo. It's quite good for the oxpecker. They get nice, fresh blood. Vampire birds, but of course it depends on the wound they do tend to keep those wounds on a buffalo open for quite a while, and that's often to keep feeding on that resource. They do it with hippo as well. And one thing you'll notice, and I'm pretty sure, and you say that none of you have ever seen an oxpecker on an elephant. And I wonder why. What do you guys think? Why do you never see an oxpecker on an elephant? They've got ticks, and they're a big animal, so they'd be a nice big feast. And you can work out why there are no oxpeckers on elephants. Send your answers through to questions@wildearth.tv. Or use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. So Ashley Rose's class is still watching. Good to have you still with us. And Javier, 3D, which is I think the school or the class, I'm not 100% sure. I would like to know how many bird species there are in South Africa. Sorry guys, it's got a head scrap there. No. And in Southern Africa, which includes South Africa, Botswana, Zimbabwe, Southern Mozambique and Namibia, there are about 980 to 190 species. You must remember there's always a good proportion of about 50 or 60, or what we call vagrants. So quite often blown off course by a big storm and end up where they're not normally are, or they're not supposed to, not that they're not supposed to be here, they just not, don't normally occur here. So about just under 1,000 species in Southern Africa. In the whole of Africa, there's about 2,000, let's see how many birds in Africa. I think it's about 2,400. That could be a little bit short, could be a little bit more. I think there are 2,100 species in sub-Saharan Africa, so that's Africa south of Sahara, so they are probably on 2,400, 2,500. There we go. And 1,400 of those species are restricted to Africa. They don't live anywhere else. There's an old buffalo bull meandering off. Hello, Grumpy. Always look at you like you owe them money. Definitely, if we had to prescribe a character to the buffalo bull, they would be the bookies of the bush, coming in to collect their debts. Maybe an old Italian gangster. So as it's, the sun is setting off to the west, I'm hoping some elephants have moved in on those massive elephant paths in this area. So we're gonna go have a quick look there. Foxcat in Florida, you're on the right track. Foxcat says that Ellie's can use their trunks to remove ticks. Well, they're very dexterous, but they're not that dexterous. Ellie's can use their trunks to swat oxpeckers is the correct answer. So sometimes, even though they can be sometimes beneficial for animals, an elephant would rather rub and mud bath itself to get rid of its ticks, and they don't really like things fluttering around their ears and rear ends. So with that long and very versatile trunk, they are able to swat oxpeckers. So that's why you don't see oxpeckers on elephants. Is that the skin of the elephant too thick for the oxpeckers? Not at all. The ticks, remember, are sitting on the surface and they often feed off the ticks. It is the the trunk that keeps the oxpeckers off. And you're correct, they do use trees as well. So they'll coat themselves in mud, and quite often those ectoparasites will be lodged in the mud, and then they'll go find a convenient rubbing post to remove the ticks. Of course, they never get all of them, but they'd probably get a vast majority like that. And we often see Ellie's using trees and stumps to have a good scratch with. Mike in Florida is on the right track. They don't tolerate the oxpeckers, and having that trunk enables them to keep the oxpeckers off. Whether it's buffalo and hippo and zebra, they can sort of just shake their head and whatnot. They can't really bite them or remove them completely. So there we go. Nice little interesting fact why you don't find oxpeckers on elephants. And speaking of elephants, it doesn't look like they've been using these highways today. So with that little bit of rain around, they've obviously spread out a bit more, and you can see there's almost no fresh Ellie tracks on these big elephant highways as we drive through the northwestern corner. Okay, so what I'm gonna do now is I'm gonna head back onto the western boundary. And fingers crossed we might find a leopard crossing back into Juma. But while we do that, let's go back and jump on with Jamie, see what she's up to.
We've got a beautiful sunset accompanying us. I almost feel like maybe I should stop. I think I will. Look at that. I was on my way in towards the hyena den just for a quick update as to what they're doing. I'm not going to stay for too long. I want to go back and check for the last few moments of our sunset safari for that leopard, but I just had to stop for the sunset. What a beautiful evening. Awesome. Sometimes it's nice just to slow down the pace a little bit when you're out on game drive and really have a look and observe and just take in the atmosphere of the evening. Let's bump our way towards the hyena den, get an update from them, and then rush out for the last few moments. Hopefully that leopard calls again. Scott had no luck with the tracks. There's also always the possibility that the sound that one of the guides maybe heard was something else that sounded very similar to a leopard. I've been fooled, particularly when you're driving, it's very difficult to hear sounds over the sound of your engine. And I've been fooled before by things like impala every now and again. What surprised me is that leopard only called once and then none of the rest of us heard it call again. It might well decide now that it's a bit cooler to start moving through. We might even have alarm calls to alert us to its presence or to give us a better idea of where it's located. Now I know that Brent's been on fine form with his bird quizzes this afternoon. It's a bit harder with track quizzes. You guys are too good. You just are too good, and I know that any of the normal tracks, normal tracks are going to be far too easy for you guys. I have to look for unusual animals to catch you out. Hello, hyena. Hello, Missy. Hello, Missy. Are you cuddling? Are you cuddling? Good afternoon. Getting so big. Oh, pretty, you're trying to block out the sun there. Are you feeling shy? You're gonna bite your own, you are biting your own leg. Cool, okay, fair enough. And ahead of us, double trouble. Oh, madam coming past. You're getting very brave, you little monsters. Wandering after a matriarch. Don't go too far. Ooh, so brave. Ooh, is that the limit? Nope, not the limit yet. Where are you going to pop out, little one? When are you going to get scared? That's very far for the December twins. Getting so brave. There you go. Coming back again. That big wide world is a little bit too scary. Now, we've often said that we would love to know what happens at this den. And Jeffrey, you were thinking about Brent's camera trap that he has. You were saying, why don't we put it in the den? Yeah, little twin wonders back. So that we could find out what they do at night. And it is one of our options. It is something we're considering. The one thing, and I know Brent has mentioned it, is I think we'll probably wait until we get a metal case welded, because the camera trap is going to run serious risks of being chewed at. Now, there's plenty of nice big trees here for us to be able to put it up high, but hyenas are, as curiosity goes, they are incredibly determined to satisfy that curiosity. Thus, we might be able to get it up high, but you might find that a hyena, we slightly underestimate the length or reach of a hyena. And if we have to put it too high, then we won't be able to get good shots of what's going on. So a nice metal case, I think, is the way forward. We have one last look at pretty feeding the November. That's attractive, pretty. That's a good look. At least she's stopped chewing her own leg. Beautiful. Mouth twitching. I wonder if she's got a sore, because apparently she did this morning. I wonder if she doesn't have a sore jaw or something. Or a sore tooth, maybe. I don't often see them sleeping like that. All of you sending through your screenshots of Andrew's beautiful sunset. Well done. And thank you for that. It was a stunning, stunning, it is a stunning evening. And after the beautiful sunset, from the sublime to now a hyena pulling a very funny face. You look very silly. Okay, let's reposition. One last look at Pretty in November. And then I'm going to go around to the other side of the den. See if we can catch up with those playful December twins. The matriarch's actually now lying down, not that far away from the den site itself. I think she just wanted some space from playing cubs. So that's where Madam is. Not far. But even that for the little December cub was a little bit too far. To let the guys know on the Game Dive channel that I'm at the hyena den and that it is active. Stations Misakaya on the road is active. And we get to watch the family social life of the spotted hyena and get a wonderful idea about their movements and their family life. But there's one thing that we will probably never have any insight into, and that's the fathers of these little playful cubs. And Crystal, you were wondering a bit more about mating. How do female hyenas choose their mate or choose who they mate with? Is it done by rank? Is it done by size or health? How is it judged? Now, I'm going to give you a sort of a partial explanation, but of course, there's still mysteries that are unsolved in terms of the way that spotted hyenas socialize with each other and how they organize their social structure. There are natal males that stay within the clan itself, and there are external males who've then become part of the clan or become accepted by the clan. Apparently, a lot of the mating is done by natal males, but obviously then with unrelated females. So because clans have different family lines, it means that they can mate with a male from the same clan without running the risk of inbreeding in any way. So it will be generally done by level of relatedness, if that makes sense. But a lot of hyena matings are also with external, large, nomadic males that come wandering through by chance and happen to then work out... Sorry, let me go this way around. Happen to then work out which way... which female is in estrus, and then they approach her and they do the courtship very, very carefully. It's a very well thought out, because the females are so much bigger and so much more aggressive than the males, it provides them with a way of, or it means that they have to be exceptionally well thought out in their approach. Whoopsies. See what I mean about determination and curiosity in order to put something in their mouths? That's why, Jeffrey, we're going to be very careful with the camera trap. And Amanda, in Queenstown, you were wondering, you were watching Big Cat Week last year, and you were wondering if these were the same hyenas that we saw on Big Cat Week. It is the same clan. And the first cub that we stopped at, the one where her mother was pulling a face, that's November, that was the tiny little bundle of fluff that you were watching last year in November in Big Cat Week. They've subsequently had two more cubs, or one of the females has had these two cubs that we first saw around December. Anal pasting around the den like an adult. They're so clever. And then we now know that there's two fairly brand new cubs that we've only started seeing recently. Their mother seems to be the matriarch of this clan. We're fairly certain in that respect. That's the one that we've been watching. We're still waiting to really get a good view of them. They've popped out once or twice. This is the hyena now known as Corky. She's the mother of the twins that you've been watching playing around her. And a warm welcome to Ashley Rose's class, 2D, who have just come in to start watching the show. It's wonderful to have you. I hope you enjoy it. Don't forget that this comes to you live from the Sabi Sands in South Africa. You guys are doing computer science. If you want to send us through questions about the spotted hyenas that you see, then let us know and we will answer any questions that you might have about these wonderful animals out here.
I saw a bug on your back.
Oh, is that why you were zooming in on me? I know.
Over here somewhere.
Where is it gone? I'll try to catch it just now for...
Look on your front left here.
Front left?
Like here.
Like here.
It crawled down your shirt.
It's crawled down my shirt. Thanks, Andrew.
It doesn't tickle you, okay?
I'll let you know if I start to squeal and wiggle. Thanks, Andrew. I'll while you have a look at those lovely hyenas, I'll do a quick search for a bug that has disappeared somewhere down my shirt. Hello. Are you so brave? Are you so brave? Come on. Come on. Oh, you're getting courageous. Come on, you little monsters. Hello. Come say hello. Come say hello. What are we? Are we mysterious? And very soon, in the next few months or so, those cubs will be coming right up to the car to have a look. They go through a phase where they are particularly curious. Andrew, you give me the thrills now.
Sorry.
I keep thinking I feel something crawling on me.
It looked pretty dangerous.
It did look like it stings. I know, I saw it flying around. It did look like it stings. Oh well, we'll soon find out. Abu Dhabi, while we sit and enjoy these incredible peaceful scenes, you were wondering why we're not getting attacked by them. And the answer is because they don't want to attack us. They feel perfectly safe in our presence. And what's more, the wild animals out here don't see us as a food source. We are not prey to them. And in fact, they are terrified of us. If I were to get out of the car now, the hyenas are very used to vehicles moving through. They grow up just like these cubs are going to, with vehicles popping in and out repeatedly. But for the rest of the animals, if I were to come out and walk past them, they would run away. The cubs would dash away. The adult would run away. The animals out here are scared of people, and they only ever, ever attack in self-defense if they feel trapped or terrified. There's something like an elephant or a hippo. Those animals can be dangerous, particularly on foot. They are wild, but nothing out here ever actively sets out to attack us. Except for these fierce, fierce cubs. You are terrifying. Wandering through with something in its mouth. Looks like a stick. Now, we spoke about the ways that hyenas choose who they mate with, or what they mate with, not what, who they mate with. And Gracie, who is one of our 8-year-old viewers, Gracie, you wanted to know if a hyena girl and a hyena boy really like each other, but they're not royalty, so they're not high ranking, can they still be in love? And yes, they can. They can still mate with each other. So a female can basically mate with whichever male she likes, and if she decides to pick the male that happens to be around her at the time that obviously she likes, then she will mate with him. She can make that decision, and because the girls are much bigger, they can actually choose who they mate with, and they can send the other males packing straight away. So yes, hyena love crosses all clan levels of hierarchy. And you don't have to be a queen or a princess to mate with the hyena that you want to. Now, while we watch Corky, who looks as though she's slipping into the first stages of sleep, we had a question about whether or not we ever see evidence of hyenas dreaming. So, for example, twitching ears, eye movement underneath the eyelids, sometimes twitching legs. And yes, I have. I have seen hyenas dream, just like our domestic dogs do. They start to twitch their legs. I've seen them chasing, and I don't know what they dream about. But they definitely dream. Legs twitch. Sometimes their lips curl up and they snarl. I'd love to know what animals actually dream about, or how detailed or vivid their dreams really are. It would be fascinating to know. Can you imagine? Now, I've ended up actually staying pretty much longer than I expected to at the hyena den. I should have known that I would get stuck and fascinated with watching these hyenas. I'm going to send you back over to Brent so that he can say have a final few moments with you, and then I will catch up with you at the end of the sunset safari.
So, welcome back. We've got the trail camera out, and I'm busy setting it up for a nocturnal chance to see. Okay, here we go. I just want to wipe off my test from earlier today. The only thing on it was Scott, Steph, Eugene, me, Jamie. So we're going to format it, clear the card so we've got a crisp new card. There we go. So I think all the settings, time, we'll see the time, so we'll see what time it comes past us. And here we go, put the video sound on. It's amazing, this is shooting in HD, almost the same resolution as the cameras on the back of the vehicles. Obviously, it doesn't quite work as well. I need to take my ears out first, don't I? Otherwise, I'm not going anywhere. So, the reason why I haven't put it at the hyena den, and the reason I've chosen this specific tree, apart from this as being the area where the servo, we've seen the servo quite a few times, is that until tomorrow, when I can get a steel encasement made for this, I'm not going to risk it with the hyenas. They will chew it to absolute pieces just because it's there. So there we go. Just make sure everything's straight. So we want it on a branch high enough, but we also want it to still look down onto the road. So we've set the sensor at about 8 meters. So it means we still will be able to see things coming. So it'll take a couple of pictures first. Before it jumps onto the video. The reason for this is the video sometimes takes a few seconds to get going, and we could miss what animal might have triggered the video. So it's always good to have the pictures, which are instantaneous, and then the video following afterwards. There we go, nice. Pop it in there, I think it's gonna be the best. So it's facing down. And the other thing, the other animal that actually sometimes causes these things quite significant damage is elephants, and that's more from curiosity. So you don't want to leave any flapping pieces of strap. So I'm going to tighten it up nicely. There we go. Just tighten it up. Press that button. Obviously, this is a higher grade exercise, and it is defeating me. There we go. Okay, that'll do. So we'll just tie this up now. There. Just make sure there's nothing flapping in the wind for the elephant to get intrigued by. Open it up now and put it on. So we will definitely be the first thing it catches as we drive away. But hopefully during the night, it's gonna catch a lot more things. Hopefully serval, maybe a honey badger. Maybe a leopard, who knows? But it's been great having you guys on the vehicle with us on this sunset safari. Don't forget to join us for the sunrise safari. And be nice to Neil, my friend who's trying out tomorrow. He'll be driving around with Scotty. So good luck to Neil. I'm sure you guys can't wait to meet him. But from Neil, myself, and Tebs on the Rust Bucket, cheers, and we'll see you tomorrow.
Still with our hyenas at the hyena den, and what a wonderful way to finish off with a beautiful afternoon drive. Now the light is absolutely perfect at this time of day, but just a reminder that we are going to be shifting our morning start time to half an hour later. So the sunrise safari will start half an hour later on the 1st of February. And that's obviously because at the moment we're driving around in pretty much solid darkness or pitch darkness for the first part of the sunrise safari. We like to try and follow the sunrises as much as possible. But thank you all for joining us, for participating in our fun games and quizzes, and for sending through all of your questions and comments. We love hearing from you. And a big thank you as well to Andrew, who, as always, has done wonderful camera work and provided some lovely company for me on the back of the vehicle, as well as to the lovely ladies in Final Control, Kirsty and Nikki. Thanks very much for a wonderful show. And for all of you, we will catch up tomorrow. Join us for the trial drive for Neil, and have a fantastic day wherever you are in the world. Cheers.